Welcome to the fourth meeting in 2013 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Members are reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. We have apologies from Maureen Watt today, and I will be standing in as convener of this session. And we welcome Gil Patterson as a substitute member for the day. I think this is your first infrastructure meeting, is that right, Gil?
Yes. Can you?
We have apologies for three of our round table discussion on RPP2, Dr. Maya Pajic, Professor Ian Doherty, and Dr. Gillian Annabley. However, we've got a very busy agenda today, so we'll just get started by considering agenda item one, business and private. And I seek the agreement of the committee to take agenda items 6, 7 and 8 in private to allow the committee to consider our approach to the community transport inquiry and to consider the evidence heard today from Edinburgh City Council on the Fourth Road Bridge Bill and the evidence heard from stakeholders on the transport aspects of RPP2. I also seek agreement to take consideration of reports on the bill and RPP2 in private at any future meetings. Will members agree to take these items in private?
Agreed.
Thanks. The second item is to hear evidence on high-speed rail from the Minister for Transport and Veterans, Keith Brown, and Peter Lloyd, Rail Policy Executive of the Scottish Government. So welcome to you this morning, gentlemen. And could I invite the Minister to make any opening remarks he wishes to make?
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to speak today on the emerging plans for high-speed rail in the UK and on Scotland's response. The committee will know that at the end of January, the Secretary of State for Transport, Patrick McLaughlin, announced the UK Government's initial preferred route for new high-speed rail lines to Manchester and Leeds, and that, of course, built upon the earlier announcement on the route from London to Birmingham. The route is currently being developed to detailed design level to support the passage of what will be a hybrid bill to approve the scheme, and I understand it will be submitted to the UK Parliament by the end of this year. Indeed, the UK Government's plan is that the Phase 1 hybrid bill will receive royal assent in 2015, with construction work starting as early as 2016. The design and approvals process of Phase 2 will follow closely behind that. The Secretary of State for Transport and his Cabinet colleagues stand firmly behind those proposals. There's no doubting, I think, that the UK Government has a real commitment to high-speed rail, and we have voiced, for our part, our support for the development of high-speed rail. However, we've also done that with a caveat, which has been stated clearly by our partnership group for high-speed rail, that's the Fast Track Scotland group, that the case for high-speed rail in the UK is significantly stronger when Scotland is fully connected to a new network. And that recognises Scotland's strong economic contribution and the strength, of course, of the Glasgow-Edinburgh city region. Indeed, Convener, you witnessed the strong support there is in Northern England for faster rail connections with Scotland at the faster, Convener Maureen Watt to witness the strong support there was at the Faster and Further High-Speed Rail Conference in November last year. The business case, though, also recognises the environmental benefits of Scotland's inclusion and the ability of high-speed rail to capture domestic aviation's leading market position. But there are also threats to realising those benefits. From 2026, new services will run from London to Glasgow on new high-speed lines where they're available, but then will have to run on the existing network. And over existing tracks, these services will actually run slower than the trains we see operating on the West Coast Main Line at present. So any journey time to Scotland, any journey time improvement will be modest. That situation improves when high-speed rail lines eventually reach Manchester and Leeds, as proposed in 2032. Journey times will be better, but north of Manchester, nothing is planned as yet to improve line capacity. Capacity, incidentally, which Network Rail says will be exhausted by the mid-2020s. Simply, there'll be little scope to provide any additional services on the line and to meet rising passenger demand. And we've always said that it doesn't seem sensible to spend all the money that's proposed on high-speed rail and then have to undertake a substantial upgrade to the West Coast Main Line because of capacity problems. If you think about the billions of pounds which have been spent just over a decade ago already on that line, there seems to us to be a more efficient way to spend public money. And the phasing of the high-speed rails construction is also of concern to us. In 2026, when Phase 1 is completed, London to Birmingham journey times will fall from 1 hour 24 minutes to only 49 minutes. That's a 42% time saving. And in 2032, when Manchester to London happens, it will take 1 hour and 8 minutes, which is an hour quicker than at present and represents a 47% saving on today's journey times. At that point, this is 2032, Glasgow to London journey times fall to 3 hours and 38 minutes. That's a saving of less than 20%. In Scotland, we'll not see overall journey time reductions of the magnitude enjoyed by others until a full high-speed line connects Edinburgh to Glasgow. There is a real potential for an extended period of relative economic disadvantage. That doesn't only fall upon Scotland, it would also impact on the north of England as well. And that was identified by Fast Track Scotland when they made their submissions, and they, of course, are made up of leading businesses and civic and transport groups. And that's why we've been pressing for high-speed rail to be developed both faster and further than the current plans. And it's also why we are playing our part in the plans so far. Our approach really has been twofold. First of all, I've already agreed with the UK Government Scotland's leading role in planning for Phase 3 of high-speed rail, that's north of Manchester and Leeds. We'll work with the DfT in developing route options for high-speed rail to Scotland. Patrick McLaughlin, you'll be aware, has already spoken of his ambition of achieving London to Scotland rail services within a three-hour journey time, and that's reflected in last month's command paper. And that paper reiterates the need for a study to address both journey time and capacity benefits on lines to Scotland. My officials are progressing with the DfT these proposals, and I'll update. We'll be able to update on the terms of the study and on the timelines and the outputs once those have been agreed. Alongside this, we've already announced planning for new high-speed rail infrastructure in Scotland, which will link Edinburgh and Glasgow, but crucially, planning ahead with provision to link that line to the south and to the existing West Coast main line in the interim period before new cross-border infrastructure is delivered. And that would provide faster access to the cities for current cross-border services, as well as a new high-speed services plan for 2026. But I'd like to make the point that a new line of this type would not only benefit Edinburgh and Glasgow, important as those benefits would be in terms of reduced travel time and economic advantage. A new line would also provide a step change in rail capacity across the Central Belt. Separating cross-border services from internal services will free capacity for better local and commuting services. A new line providing the majority of end-to-end Edinburgh to Glasgow journeys could relieve pressure on existing services and allow better connectivity for those communities on existing lines. It could also allow for the development of new stations and better train paths and times for services between the Central Belt and Inverness, Aberdeen, Dundee, Perth and all the intermediate stops. These potential benefits will be considered in our outline business case planning, which will report to me in spring 2014. I don't doubt the UK Government's commitment to press ahead with a high-speed rail project, and we have to plan ahead to see the greatest and earliest benefits to Scotland from those proposals, and that's why we've adopted this twin approach. With partnership planning for high-speed rail from the north of England to Scotland, and I also hope to again go to the north of England in the next few weeks to build that case with some of our partners in the north of England. But also we want to realise at the earliest possible opportunity the benefits of a new line from Edinburgh to Glasgow and to spread those benefits as widely as possible across Scotland. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Minister. Can I ask Alec Johnson to kick off our questions?
Thank you very much, Convener. Could I ask the Minister to expand slightly on how specifically the Scottish Government is engaging in the development of HS2 at a political and official level?
Well, we've had a number of meetings, both with the previous Transport Secretary, Justin Greening. We asked her to come to Scotland to discuss these issues, a number of letters and correspondence as well. In addition to that, a number of phone calls, including with Patrick McLaughlin, putting the case for us to be involved as soon as possible. And the way we've done that is to try and work in concert with the partnership group. And I think that's been a real strength because you have a group there which includes businesses, trade unions, civic partnerships and those very involved in transport. And I do think it adds a different dimension to the representations that we've made to the UK government to say there's a broad base of support for this in Scotland. There's also the opportunity in the meantime, I think, whilst we're a bit further away from some of more contentious issues which they're having to deal with, especially in the furthest south parts of the new proposed line, to keep that unity going. So that's the way we've tried to do it. There's been obviously substantial discussions between officials at DfT and officials in the Scottish Government, and we've had debates in the Parliament, there's been letters. So we've had a fairly constant dialogue with UK ministers to try and put the case for Scotland to be included at the earliest possible opportunity.
In your opening remarks, the Minister made it very clear how he reacted to the announcement of the latest information on Phase 2 of the HS2 project. I'm inclined to agree with the Minister that this is one of these projects which really has to be tackled on a UK-wide basis. But does the Minister not see that this is very much a UK project, and that any break in the relationship between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom may simply mean that Scotland has a much greater part of the cost to bear?
Absolutely not. And I think if you look at the way that the UK has dealt with rail services to Scotland up till now, you remember the promises we've had from previous governments to have Euro services going from Scotland straight to Paris. The fact is, you can get a train from London to Paris and you can be there in 2 hours, and yet it still takes 4 hours to come from London to Edinburgh or Glasgow. So I don't think you can say that the way that rail services, especially these cross-border rail services, have developed has been well served by previous UK governments. And it's also true to say that if you look across Europe, it's quite possible to get both high-speed and non-high-speed rail services between any number of different countries. So it's perfectly possible to adapt these services. And I suppose if you want to be superficial about it, you could say that where there's been different countries in Europe, if you go to Belgium, France, Holland, Germany, they've managed, despite being different countries, to have a far better development of high-speed rail services than we seem to have managed within the UK. So I don't think the question of future constitutional change does anything but, I think, help the possibility of improving those services which we currently have.
So you would see a future United Kingdom government engaging in the construction of railways within an independent Scotland?
Well, I think that's one of the vital points. People tend to assume sometimes that this is all about trying to improve benefits for Scotland in arguments. There are massive benefits for London and the rest of England in having proper high-speed services to Scotland. The amount of trade which is carried on, the potential for benefit in both countries, is huge, and that would persist regardless of the constitutional settlement.
Gil Paterson.
Minister, on that point, the Parliament paid a visit to America at Tartanday a couple of years ago. I was there. And I was struck with the fact that the American plans for development of a high-speed rail link relied on a route into Canada. And there's cooperation, close cooperation. I wonder if you have any comments on that, or have you any knowledge of it in regards to how two economic units approach matters for their own interests.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's substantial cooperation between the USA and Canada, and they realise that benefits their economy and also both countries. I think I'm right in saying the Canadian National Railways were developed by a Scot in the first place many years ago. But they seem to have no problem collaborating. There's some interesting thinking coming out of the United States. I think a professor, Richard Florida, has had this idea of mega regions, which he says, if served by high-speed rail, can be hugely beneficial to the economies of those areas. And he doesn't specify countries. It's where these areas, usually served by large cities, can massively benefit from improved rail links. So it's not really about borders for them. It's about developing the economic potential in different areas. And there's a lot we can learn, I think, from the way that the US and Canada seem to cooperate on these things.
And the point that Mr. Johnson makes is, it not likely that since we've been totally ignored, business has been totally ignored with regards to the promises, building carriages that effectively get used elsewhere that were promised for Scotland, that most likely if it was an independent country we'd get a better deal than relying on folk actually making promises that never materialise, like a vital route through the Channel Tunnel?
I think there is some cynicism because of past commitments which have been broken. There's no doubt about that. But I would also say that there seems to me to be, both in Justin Greening previously and Patrick McLaughlin, a willingness to really address this issue. We've had a fairly constructive discussion with UK government. It still remains the case, I would have to say, that neither the previous Labour government nor this government as yet have committed to high-speed rail to Scotland. But I do see the fact that the current UK government is engaging with us quite constructively as promising. We've also said to the UK government there's a lot we can do to help out. We can crack on fairly quickly with the development of high-speed rail. In fact, we've announced our own proposals for Edinburgh to Glasgow in a way that might be much quicker to start than some of the more problematic areas, especially going through the Chilterns and so on as well. So we've tried, and there's no reason why you have to start a line at one point and move linear, in a linear fashion to another point. You can start at different points, which is what we're doing in the Borders Rail. So I think it's important to try and keep that constructive discussion going. And as I say, I don't think it will be constitutional change will be a driver in that. It's understood that Scotland's going to have to contribute to high-speed rail in any event, in terms of financially. So I think this is well to try and maintain a productive relationship with the UK government right through this process.
Yes, thanks very much.
Yeah, in terms of the phase two of the high-speed rail, I mean, estimated completion date is 2033, which is a long time away. In terms of your own thinking, are the Scottish government hoping actually to get something underway within the next decade or so? Is that a possibility?
Well, we will do that. I mean, our proposal is to have the Edinburgh Glasgow electrification completed by 2024. I think the date I've been given is 2032 for the completion of phase two of High Speed 2. And just to underline the point that you've made, Convener, we have said to the UK government, we don't feel we have to wait that long. In fact, we think there's real benefits to be had from moving more quickly in relation to this. So we haven't accepted the position that by 2032, that's when we start looking at further development. We are trying to push for that happening just now. And I've tried to point out where that's in the UK government's interest as well as Scotland's interest too.
Thank you. Elaine, you want to...
Thank you, Convener. You'd say that the business case is going to be produced in 2014. Is that the sort of timescale for some more information about indicative routes and costings and so on? Is that, would that be part of your business case, that we'd get more information at that point, or do you think there would be further detail earlier on?
The business case I was referring to, I think, for 2014 was the Edinburgh to Glasgow proposal that we have ourselves. Yeah. But obviously that is an important point in relation to how that would tie in to the routes going south as well. But as I say, we'll receive that in spring next year.
Yeah, I just wondered, I mean, as somebody who knows the West Coast mainline fairly well, how it will actually reduce times and by how much it will reduce times prior to the high-speed rail link to the south coming up, because at the moment you can change at Carlisle or Lockerbie or Carstairs, and Carstairs, the route branches between Edinburgh and Glasgow. I can't quite envisage personally how going up to Glasgow and then taking a high-speed train over to Edinburgh will make that faster than changing at Carstairs or Lockerbie.
I maybe ask Peter to come in relation to that, but of course what we are saying, part of what the Glasgow-Edinburgh proposal is about is to show the eagerness of ourselves to get on with this. I mean, one of the criticisms, mild criticisms in the past, well, you know, what's Scotland doing? Well, we are, you know, putting our cards on the table and showing a real level of commitment, and it will provide improvements, which I mentioned to Peter, although they will not be nearly as much as they should be if that part between the central belt of Scotland and the rest of the West Coast mainline going down is not improved, because by 2024, at the very point at which we hope to have established Edinburgh to Glasgow electrification, high-speed link, the capacity will have been reached on the West Coast, mate, so it'll be clogging up at that point. But maybe ask Peter if I can come in on that.
Yes, the proposition that we're going to test through business case planning will test a direct Edinburgh-Glasgow line, but also a connection to the existing West Coast mainline. There'll be an option for that within the business planning. I think in terms of cross-border journey times, this offers an advantage to bypass some of the quite congested parts of the existing rail network and improve both current cross-border journey times and also support the introduction of high-speed services, which will run, you know, to Birmingham on high-speed line, then to Manchester on high-speed line, then continue to Scotland. So I think there are journey time benefits there to be investigated. But also as part of that, as Minister's alluded to in his statement, how the separation of cross-border traffic as part of that scheme could benefit the existing network in terms of release capacity, the ability to deliver, you know, better local and commuting services across the central belt as well.
I can certainly see that if you're taking the fast routes off the commuter services, that you would actually be able to improve commuter services. Just my difficulty is in understanding how that will work in 2024 when it's linking into the West Coast Main Line and you've still got the freight and the other slower stopping services and so on, still on that line.
But there are still going to be considerable capacity problems on the West Coast Main Line, and that's what we'll work with, work together with DfT and the HS2 company with on this planning of, if you like, phase three of high speed rail, the parts from Manchester or Leeds northwards. And it may not be the West Coast Main Line, it may be an eastern alignment, it may be a western alignment, and that will come out through the appraisal of the options. We can't probably rule anything out at this time for those processes. What DfT have, or what the Secretary of State has offered in his command paper is a joint study which will consider connections northwards, and that could be in the terms of the command paper, the building of entirely new line, parts of new line and parts of upgrade, upgraded line. But the options are open, and therefore the terms of that study.
Margaret.
Morning, Minister. The Scottish Government published an update to its infrastructure investment plan earlier this month, but it didn't make any reference to the proposed Edinburgh-Glasgow high-speed line. Can you tell me why this wasn't included?
I think, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, this has come forward very recently, and we're not at the stage where we can put, just as the UK Government doesn't yet know how it will fund high-speed rail, the proposal it has, we have to work out the costing for that, first of all, and what the potential is for that. So we're at the very early stages of this. It's perhaps just a question of timing as much as anything else.
Jim.
Thank you, Convener. Staying with the Edinburgh-Glasgow high-speed line, can I ask if you could put some further meat on the bones? In terms of the opening remarks you made earlier, you highlighted a number of possible potential benefits. If I heard you correctly, I think you said rail capacity across the central belt could be improved, there would be better connectivity, new stations perhaps, and possibly improved journey times. Has there been a cost-benefit analysis that would allow us to put some figures on the assertions that have been made to allow us to better understand what the benefits are, but also what the costs of providing those would actually be? I think how does that compare with other transport investments that the Scottish Government is making?
They will have to be done on that basis. The cost-benefit ratio is a sort of fundamental part of any of the major transport projects we undertake. But we're just starting that process now. That's why we'll have the report coming forward in spring next year. But I think it's perfectly possible to see, even at this stage, that if, for example, just now we have a number of requests to have additional stations between Edinburgh and Glasgow on different lines. If we incorporate those, that has an impact inevitably on journey times, because obviously you've got further stopping and starting and picking up passengers at different locations. And the establishment of the high-speed link between Edinburgh and Glasgow will take the bulk of the direct services, direct journeys between those two cities. So in doing that, you're freeing up capacity elsewhere. Plus, you're also giving the option for those that are most concerned with fast journey times. And there is a figure which I can't bring to mind just now of, for every minute you take off that, the economic benefit is pretty huge, surprisingly large. So you have the option with the high speed link of taking the direct journeys and getting the best possible journey times, but you also free up the capacity elsewhere, such that if, one a proposal is that West Lothian Council would like to see a station developed at Winchborough. But one of the considerations you'd have about that just now is how will that impact on journey times on that line? Well, that's less of a consideration if people have the option for the fast journey times. So it releases capacity to look at serving more places with the other lines that we have. So we know that from now, but the actual working out of the costs and benefits of that will have to be part of the study which we've commissioned and will come back in spring next year.
Okay. Just for completeness and for the record, who is conducting that piece of work?
Who specifically? I think Peter could
and
tell
do we know how much that is costing?
We are.
pardon me. They'll be taken forward by Transport Scotland. We'll identify costs. We're going out to a tendering exercise to bring in advice on that at the moment. That's certainly something we can update the committee with later on. That's an ongoing process and we hope to have that completed very shortly.
The process for the work hasn't begun, but you expect a report to be produced by
spring of next year. A report will come to me next year in spring next year,
Thank you.
Okay, Gordon MacDonald.
Okay, thanks, Convener. In your evidence in December, you stated that Justin Greening had agreed that we can interact with HS2 Limited, the high-speed rail company. Is the intention is to establish a company to build the Scottish end of the high-speed line on similar lines to HS2, or how, what is the delivery vehicle?
No current intention to establish a separate company for that. We certainly not want to duplicate anything which is already there. I mean, HS2 is a very particular type of organisation which looks created for that purpose, but looks specifically at all the planning, the route development and the costings as well. So I don't think we'd want to necessarily replicate that. But again, unfortunately, this is us coming into the process now. We haven't been involved in the process before now, so we have to start with those that are establishing the high-speed proposals, phase one and phase two in England. We have to start with them because obviously things follow on from the routes and development that they have. So we think at this stage the best option is for us to work with High Speed 2. We've asked to do that a number of months, I think possibly even years ago. It's now happening, and I think we have to see how that develops through before we work out delivery options for this. We don't have any agreement from the UK government to deliver high-speed rail north of the areas which I've mentioned. So until we have that, I don't think we can have a clearer idea on delivery options.
You also indicated previously that the investment in Egypt was made in an understanding of how that might impact on the project and how we might best facilitate the development of high-speed rail, and also the two things were complementary. Can you clarify whether both projects will be developed in tandem or run as separate projects?
On the high-speed rail link that we're having responsibility for between Edinburgh and Glasgow, yes. I mean, obviously, what we propose to do there and the study, which, once the tendering process is complete, which is looked into, will take into account what Egypt is doing. And our initial announcement on Egypt recognised the fact that we did not want to undertake any work or any expense which would then be superseded by high-speed rail. That was part of the point about that. So we do have the benefit now of the study which is going to be done. It's been done in the full knowledge of what Egypt will produce and making sure it's complementary and it's not going to duplicate expenditure. I don't know if you want to say more on that, Peter.
At the moment, passenger journeys in Scotland are around 82 million a year. We reckon by the mid-period of the next decade, it rises to about 100 million. And clearly, as the Minister said, that the majority of that of that activity will be across the Central Belt. And as we look forward to how the lines will cope with that demand, we also think about how we best serve the needs of the end-to-end markets and the intermediate markets. And clearly, rail works best if it's you can't have fast journey times and additional stops. And what the high-speed project allows is an abstraction of a lot of that demand from the existing lines to improve, as a local commuting services. It would also, and this is something we'll have to model in more detail, is the effect on some of the key junctions to the north and the congestion round about those. If the option is to try and put serve a faster Edinburgh Glasgow connection on the existing lines, that could have adverse effects for wider realising wider benefits on the network. So the question is one of abstraction. It's taking the bulk of the end-to-end Glasgow-Edinburgh rail travel market out of the existing network and let that be used for more developed services, recognising more sort of local needs.
Thanks very much.
Okay. Finally, Minister, can you provide an update on the work and current objectives of the Scottish Partnership Group for High-Speed Rail?
Well, obviously, the work they've done up till now is culminated in the report which they produced. Now, we think they were very important in getting even as far as we have done. I think UK ministers in particular are very receptive, or more receptive, to broad-based representations, which they know include the business community, the councils, various councils, and Civic Scotland as well. I think we would want to make sure that that continues. I've mentioned already, I hope to go to the north of England in the next few weeks to continue building the case that we have started to build with partners there. And I think that the partnership has got a crucial role to play in making sure those representations continue to be made to the UK government. I think from the UK government's point of view, if you look at the announcement they've made, and it is very contentious. It goes through some very sensitive areas of England.
And of course, there are very different, diverse points of view about whether high-speed rail is the best option for them. I think looking to Scotland to understand the unanimity which is there and exemplified by the partnership group is a reassuring thing for the UK government. This is not to say, of course, that when we get down to the point of specifying routes, we'll not get contention there as well. That's bound to happen. But I think the partnership group has played a very crucial role so far and will continue to do so. As to exactly what their role is, it's not for me to prescribe to them. We'll have to come to an agreement with them as to how they actually carry that forward in future.
Gordon MacDonald, do you want to come in?
Yeah, it's actually an unrelated matter, but I just thought I'd ask it at the end, because later on we're taking evidence on it on another issue, which is in your portfolio. So, while we're here, could you provide any clarification about suggestions in the press that Edinburgh Council fears it could be left with liabilities and that Scottish ministers are not prepared to meet all FETA's liabilities in the event of FETA being wound up? Are they right to be concerned?
Yeah, I did see that this morning in the press, and it puzzles me. We've made it very clear that FETA, which will be organised through Scottish ministers, will be picking up all the compensation claims which are there.
Aston next week to give us some evidence okay. on that front, Minister, so we can follow up with you then.
Okay.
Can I thank you very much for the evidence you've given this morning, and we'll briefly suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to leave. Thank you. The item we have on the agenda today is to hear evidence at stage one of the fourth road bridge bill from City of Edinburgh Council. City of Edinburgh Council submitted a written statement to the committee on the 1st of February and supplementary written evidence on the 13th of February this year. So could I welcome the witnesses and thank them for their written submission. And this morning we have Councillor Lesley Hinds, who's the convener of the Transport and Environment Committee, and Ewan Kennedy, Transport Policy and Planning Manager. So could I invite questions to both, please? And we start with Margaret.
Both of you. In your written evidence, you did raise concerns about the dissolution of FETA by removing councillors from any frontline role in the management of the fourth bridges. Can you tell me what practical implications this could have on the cross-fourth transport?
You will be aware by the evidence, I'm sure you're aware, that the FETA, as set up at the moment, has elected members from a number of local authorities. And we have a number who sit on that FETA board, which is all party, but also local elected member as well, who sits on that board. So it gives both a strategic in terms of transport, but also a local level. So we felt that if we are to have a forum which then is set up to replace FETA, we feel that directly elected councillors would be beneficial in terms of that, while we have two bridges at the moment, about to have three bridges, the importance to Edinburgh in terms of the economy and importance in terms of iconic, if you want to call them buildings, but iconic situation there in terms of visitors and tourism, which is always extremely important, and also to the local community, particularly in South Queen's Ferry. So we feel that, you know, I'm sure all parties say that they want to have less quangos, less people that are unelected. So we feel that this forum would be an opportunity to have elected members who are directly elected representing the community, but also in terms of transport strategic as well.
Okay, and I mean, by having the councillors as members, I mean, what do you think their membership might actually overall add to the operation that it wouldn't able to be given under the new setting?
Well, because we have officers, and no detriment to officers, but as elected members, we, you know, are elected. The local community in particular, I mentioned before about South Queen's Ferry, they've had a very good relationship with the FETA board, and there's been very good, you know, consultation. And also because of the network, I believe that elected members would give an added impetus in terms of representing the community. And obviously, officers will give more a technical background, but particularly representing the local community and the council as a whole.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Gil?
Yeah, on that matter, when it comes to the forum itself, have you any suggested changes that need to be made to accommodate councillors on it? And a related question, would that be the local councillor, the ward councillor, or is it just councillors?
I think it would, I mean, obviously that would be up to yourselves whether recommendations or for the minister or for part of this. But we just feel in principle we would like to have a elected members. Now, whether that's one who would represent the local community or two, but particularly Edinburgh, which is, you know, would the local authority be affected? You know, I know some of the other local authorities haven't made comments, but we just feel quite strongly whether there was at least one elected member, and that would be up to that local authority to decide on whether it would be appropriate to have the transport convener, for example, or to have a locally elected member. But we'd like to at least have one elected member from Edinburgh on that forum.
So that effectively would be two, because you would need one from the other side, wouldn't you? Is that what you're suggesting? Yeah. That kind of number, is that?
Well, I think the majority, there are a number on just now of local authorities in West Lothian as well, but the two authorities that are mostly affected are Fife and Edinburgh, and they're the ones that have been very active. And, for example, the convener and vice-convener of FETA has always been traditionally been Edinburgh as a convener, Fife the vice-convener, and then it changes about. So those are the two authorities, I would say. I don't want to say other local authorities aren't important, but those are the two local authorities who are really directly affected in terms of economy, etc., by the bridges.
Yeah, just to press you a wee bit further, so you're thinking it may be two, but maybe possibly everyone associated with it, all the councils associated. So it might be quite a number then in that regard.
Well, I would don't like to suggest, but I will suggest that, you know, the two local authorities in particular are Fife and Edinburgh, and if the committee felt they wanted to recommend, or the minister felt that elected members, councillors on that forum, then those two local authorities, I would say, would be the ones that I think should be represented.
Elaine Murray,
please. Yes, I wanted to touch on the issue about the compensation that obviously Edinburgh City Council is concerned about, the compensations arising from the M9 Spur A90 project. Transport Scotland have disagreed. They've said that that would be adequately covered by the £600,000 in the financial memorandum, but Edinburgh City Council believe, on the basis of claims which have been submitted, it could be up as much as £4.4 million, and that when FETA is dissolved, that liability would not automatically transfer to Scottish ministers and could rest with the council. Could you say a bit more about your concerns?
I'll maybe ask Ewan to do the more technical part, but in principle, what we've got, we need to be have some comfort as a local authority that when FETA is abolished and we go over into the new system, and that we don't have liabilities, financial liabilities. And as an elected member, I'm sure you would want us to make sure that any council taxpayers' money that we're protecting. So we want comfort in that. But perhaps I could ask, if you don't mind, Ewan, who's been more involved, and we have had further discussions with Transport Scotland, and I understand that they are reasonably fruitful.
And do you want to?
Is that okay? Yeah.
Thank you. Good morning. Just a quick background to this. This is an issue that relates to the construction of the M9 link road, which was a link road promoted by FETA shortly after it came into being in 2002. when it became a transport authority, and that gave them powers to, as well as maintain the existing bridge, to introduce or construct measures in and around the bridge. They looked around how best to procure that, and they opted and they asked Edinburgh City Council to act as their agent to design and construct and deliver the M9 Link Road, on the understanding that all costs incurred by the council would be reimbursed from FETA. Now, where the issue has arisen is really around liabilities and where liabilities sit. The council proceeded, and it was the council that entered into contracts. It was so that effectively the liability sat with council. But the particular issue that is outstanding is the council used its powers, compulsory purchase powers, to acquire the land. And obviously the road is now built, the land has been obtained, but there are outstanding claims from landowners that could still end up in an arbitration, and that situation will pertain until October 2013 this year. So in constructing the bill, Transport Scotland were looking at FETA liabilities, but the City Edinburgh Council liabilities weren't totally transparent. And since the submission by the council and subsequent conversations with Transport Scotland, Transport Scotland were unaware of the fact that the council used its powers to acquire. And the figures that are in the public domain, the council's best estimates of the likely level of compensation is 93,000. There's 180 claims on the table, and the combined sum of those claims, which are the former landowners, is 4.4 million. And this could end up being resolved through an arbitration by a lands tribunal, and we don't have no certainty in the outcome of that. Now, our belief is that the 4.4 million is a figure not likely that will come to pass. But it's perfectly possible that a figure higher than 93 could come to pass. So it's really the council safeguarding its position. The relationship between FETA and the council has been absolutely fine, and all council's expenditure thus far has been covered by FETA. But obviously, in dissolving FETA, we were just wanting to ensure that those liabilities were being properly taken account of.
So this... The concern is over, presumably it's about the valuation of the land that was compulsory purchased, is it? Yeah, so that's different. I think there's two different compensations here. There's a compensation for noise and fumes and that sort of compensation, but there's also presumably the dispute over the value of the land. Will the land remain in the ownership of Edinburgh City Council?
No, the road in question is becoming a trunk road. And in fact, it probably is a trunk road now. It became a trunk road as virtue of the build to construct.
The land that was purchased will transfer to the ownership of Transport Scotland.
That's correct. Yeah.
Given the sort of, it's quite important given the sums of money which could be involved. Was there any effort by Transport Scotland to consult with the council as it was drawing up the bill?
The first formal consultation that we got was the official consultation that came in kind of late autumn, early winter. That's not to say that official level, obviously there's been ongoing discussions between City Council and FETA in regard to the outstanding matters around the construction of the road. I think I'm not quite sure how this situation has arisen. It's not been transparent that this liability is sitting with the council hasn't been picked up as effectively a FETA liability.
Would actually be that sort of comfort you need is a declaration by the minister when he comes to see us that it will definitely not be the liability of Edinburgh City Council. Is that sufficient to have that on the record, or is it something else?
I think a statement that all liabilities associated with the construction of the M9 Link Road will pass the Scottish ministers.
But I have to say there has been some constructive discussions following statements that were given out to the press, etc. And I think there's now been an understanding from Transport Scotland of where the council's coming from, and there has been constructive discussion, so we feel a bit more comfort that that discussion is ongoing.
Gordon MacDonald.
Just on the point, I mean, what Barry Colford said when he was in on the 6th of February was that anyone can put in a claim, and I imagine that the council's figure comes from an accumulation of all these claims. All I can say that our budgeted cost is £623,000, which is made up of £190,000 of potential claims and £433,000 of outstanding fees. You've said yourself this morning that the value of £4.4 million is not likely to come to pass. So has there been any claims on these compulsory purchases of land actually been settled out of the 180 claims, or has there been settlement done that's out with that 180?
Yeah, I mean, there's 180 claims outstanding. There has been settlement around other land deals that were part of the construction of the road. So we have 180 outstanding.
What proportion of that, of all the compulsory purchase deals, is that 180? Is it the vast majority that are still outstanding, or is it 1%, 2%? I mean, where is it in the range?
In the range. I don't have that detail with me. I could submit that separately if committee required.
Right. And if it was a situation where, and I know there's been discussions and understanding, and I think Keith Brown started to allude earlier on that they would be picking up all liabilities relating to the situation, but if that was to be the, that wasn't to be the case, what effect would it have on the council's budget, bearing in mind the size of the council's budget?
Any, as council taxpayers, I'm sure it doesn't matter whether it's 1,000 or whether it's 1 million, it's £1 billion budget, but we budget, you know, and these liabilities we haven't budgeted for, and therefore it would have an effect in terms of we would have to either find savings or find it from somewhere else. So it would have an effect on the budget because we've not got these liabilities within our budget.
But there would also be savings in the council's budget because you would no longer be responsible for some of the services that you provide to FETA.
But that was not till 2015, and that will be then planned in terms of our budget, the same as, you know, the police and fire this year. Then we'll have less in our budget come 2015, and when FETA is not there no more, then we'll obviously be planning and budgets in terms to the what we give, like committee support, financial support, etc. Then that will obviously have to be taken into account and for 2015, and there's been work being done already on that.
Jim.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask a couple of questions. One about the Fourth Bridges Forum and then about the public and active travel corridor. Now, if I could start with the Fourth Bridges Forum. I was interested in the earlier conversation and the point that you made, I thought rather effectively, that there was a need for directly elected representatives to be on the board. On the Fourth Bridges Forum, as they had previously been on the board of FETA. But I'm just wondering, are there any other mechanisms that you think would help to facilitate and foster the good working relationship that you would want to see between the road operator and local authorities? Clearly that's an important one, but are there other mechanisms that would be helpful?
Well, I think particularly the bridge master and the team that are there have had a very good relationship, I know, with South Queens Ferry. I know South Queens Ferry reasonably well, and I know that they feel that relationship has been very very good. So I wouldn't like to speak on their behalf, but perhaps some of the mechanisms that they've had in terms of regular meetings with the bridge master, any issues that are coming up, to ensure that happens. And I'm sure with staff transferring over, then those same staff will be dealing with the community. So whether you had a representative on the forum, but I think if you had an elected member on the forum, then that elected member, whoever that person was, could, I'm sure, ensure that they would meet on a regular basis with the communities, whether it was South Queens Ferry, particularly in the Edinburgh area, which is directly affected.
That's helpful. And having the local elected member provides a voice and a platform for the local community and any concerns and issues that they may have about how the bridge is being operated and what impact that perhaps is having on surrounding roads.
Yeah, in particular when there are some problems, have been in the past, but as I say, there is a good relationship between the bridge master and their staff at the moment, with the community council in particular, who is very active
Community Council, and obviously the benefits in terms of they've just managed to get a bid business improvement district in South Queen's Ferry, and obviously how that links into tourism, etc., and how we can do that. And whether it was a locally elected member, if they agreed to have a locally a councillor on that forum, even if it wasn't a locally elected member, we work in Edinburgh. Well, I hope we work in Edinburgh in terms of all party, and to ensure that locally elected members, there's three at the moment, would ensure that they were their voice was heard as well.
Thank you for that. Can I ask you then about the public and active travel corridor? My colleagues will be aware that I regularly ask questions about active travel and cycling in particular, as I have a lot of constituents who cycle to and from work. But what is the council doing to ensure that buses, cyclists and pedestrians have as smooth and quick a journey as possible to and from the southern access of the bridge, from the opening of the bridge?
We have a local active action plan, which is seen throughout the country as one of the best. And that is about cycling, it's about walking, as you will know. It would seem, I think it's been reviewed in the next few months, and obviously one of those reviews would be in terms of the new bridge construction and then how we can then make sure that active travel is worked out. And also there's discussions with Fife as well, because of the number of people who live in Fife but also work in Edinburgh, and the other way about, than people who live in Edinburgh and work in Fife. And there has been some funding available from the Minister, which will improve that active travel, particularly cycle network, from the bridge into Edinburgh. And I think that's been constructed at the moment. But that money, we welcome, has come forward. So, as I say, we're going to review the active travel action plan. And one of the key points would be, with the new bridge coming on board, how can we ensure that part around South Queensferry, but from Fife's perspective, in the north part as well, and how we can make sure we encourage people to walk and cycle.
You mentioned the iconic status of the bridge, and clearly, and also the travel to and from Fife. So can I ask you, have there been any discussions between City of Edinburgh Council and Fife Council on ensuring that we maximise the benefits of having a cycle corridor between Fife and Edinburgh?
We're in officers, my answer,
There's a public transport access strategy.
And what discussions specifically have taken place between the two councils to maximise the benefits of this opportunity?
In terms of cycling?
Cycling corridor, active travel corridor, between the two.
I think it's all part and parcel of the package that West Lothian, Fife and Edinburgh, along with Sestran, put together, along with Transport Scotland, when the bill was being promoted for the bridge. And that output a range of facilities, park and ride, bus lanes, cycle facilities. And that is a piece of work that we continue to work with Transport Scotland and our partner authorities. In there are contained a range of measures that are kind of short-term, medium-term, long-term. And it's all part and parcel of a sustainable transport approach to managing growth over cross-Forth trips, over the Forth, and having the key parts of that in place at 2016 when the bridge opens, and looking into the future. So, as I say, there's a range of measures in there that include active travel, includes cycling. We made a very strong point at the time when the bill was going through about facilities on the existing bridge for walking and cycling. We went as far as actually suggesting that there should be perhaps facilities on the new bridge at the time. But I think the key document in that, the key strategy in that between the councils and Transport Scotland is that strategy.
As an Edinburgh MSP, I'm well aware that City of Edinburgh Council is an exemplar in this area and has very good policies in place. But I just wanted to give you that opportunity to put those comments on the record. Thank you.
Okay, on that pleasant note, shall we? Can I thank Councillor Hinds and Mr Kennedy for their evidence this morning, and as intimated earlier, we'll be taking this forward with the Minister next week. Thank you. Could we briefly suspend the meeting, and you might get that coffee going. Agenda item is to discuss the transport element of the Scottish Government's draft RPP2 report, and I welcome the witnesses attending today. This item is going to be taken in a round table format, which is intended to allow a free flow of discussion. There'll be no opening statements from witnesses. Obviously, I'll be asking you to introduce yourselves and your organisations, but this will be followed by an open discussion. And I would ask both witnesses and committee members to catch my eye when you want to speak, and we'll hopefully do this through the chair. So could I firstly invite our guests to introduce themselves and their organisation? Maybe start with yourself, Tom.
Yes, my name's Tom Ballantyne. I'm chair of Stop Climate Chaos Scotland.
I'm Peter Hawkins. I'm from Spokes, which is the Lothian Cycle Campaign, and I'm also a representative of CTC, which is the National Association of Cyclists.
Keith Irving, head of Living Street Scotland.
Colin Howden, director of Transform Scotland.
Nigel Holmes, representing the 2020 Climate Group subgroup on transport.
Thanks very much. Well, what we're hoping to do today is to address a number of themes. Firstly, progress since RPP1. Secondly, the content and format of RPP2. And then the four decarbonising initiatives that are contained in the document. The RPP2 document, decarbonising vehicles, sustainable communities and business engagement around sustainable transport. And I think intelligent traffic systems is included there as well. So can perhaps begin the discussion by asking for comments on progress since RPP1. So what progress have we made in terms of reducing transport emissions since RPP1 was published, and how should this be reported in RPP2? Anyone?
I could start with a general comment, which is that it's difficult to say how well we've progressed, but what we do know is that we've missed our first target on emissions overall, and we also know that transport emissions have gone up and not down. So I think it is difficult to say, because of the way, or the lack of clear data, it's difficult to say what progress we've been made, but certainly those big scale indicators are not very encouraging.
Just to build on Tom's point, you know, I see a big contrast with the clarity of reporting with the energy progress with the renewables route map, where they set out the progress annually, the targets they've got for 2020. I don't see anything that's got quite that same clarity for the transport sector.
Colin?
Yeah, just on the same theme, I mean, just to flag up the SPICE briefing, which said at page 5 that they, having had examined the documentation, that they concluded that they could not provide any detailed breakdowns for some critical sectors, most notably transport. Now, SPICE has got considerably more analytic function than Transform Scotland has, for example, and or capacity rather, perhaps, rather than function. And if they have not been able to make sense of the document, it's going to be very difficult for us to make any detailed appreciation of progress since RPP1. There isn't sufficient information on monitoring in RPP2 to allow us to make any detailed appreciation.
Right, and yourself, nothing to add to that. Okay. In terms of whether witnesses feel the draft RPP2 contains sufficient detail on transport policies and proposals, could you maybe articulate your thoughts on that and that area?
I think I've kind of been given the task of giving you the big picture, if I can. We had three kind of markers. Was the RPP2 ambitious, credible, and transparent? And by ambitious, we mean, is it sufficient to meet our targets By credible, we mean, does that plan, when you look at it in detail, provide the comfort that we're going to meet the targets, and transparency speaks for itself. What we know from what we've seen so far is that RPP2 relies heavily on the EU shifting its targets for reductions in emissions. We know that unless we deliver on all the policies and proposals, we're not going to meet our targets. So the first thing to be said is that leaves us no headroom, no room for error in any of that. We've got to deliver everything to the maximum, which is not a very good situation to be in. When you look at the RPP2, the big concern is that too much of it is unfunded, unspecific, and difficult to tell actually how it's going to deliver particular amounts of emission reductions. So there's a great concern there. A lot of the stuff on transport is given as proposals. There's virtually nothing in the way of policies. It's just basically the shift in EU policy. Transparency, what we're looking for is, I suppose it's fairly obvious, show us precisely what will be done, show us how that will meet targets, monitor it, evaluate it, and then let's come back and think about it again. So in terms of transparency, we think a lot more should be done.
Can I just ask, Convener, on those points that you've made, which are fairly damning in their indictment of the current position, presumably you have made them to government and you've had a response. What has that response been?
I think that the government position is that on a lot of the issue of both delivery and transparency, it's difficult to be certain as to how particular policies will play out over time. So, for instance, when it comes to 2025 to 2027, there's a fairly large reduction in emissions put at that stage without any clarity as to how they're to be delivered. I understand the government position to be that it's difficult to be clear about that period because it's so far away, but others may have other comments on that.
Alec and then Colin.
Yeah, I was just going to mention specifically on that. On many subjects, we have a range of figures, which of course we may or may not achieve. But looking particularly at the table that appears on page 136 of the document, where it relates to lower emission potential in transport, does it surprise you that we expect to go from a cold start in 2025 to achieve 750 kilotons a year saving by 2027?
It does surprise me in particular because there's no explanation really as to how that's to be done. So yes, I think the short answer is it does surprise me.
Do you think in that particular column that we're in think of a number territory?
Well, I think we're certainly in the territory of wanting some evidence as to how this figure is to be achieved. We want to see the detail to show us how this is to be achieved. At the moment, it certainly has the look of something that's been slightly plucked out of the air without any apparent justification.
I just add that, yes, absolutely, that emission savings that comes in the final 3 years, 2025 to 2027, also comes at no additional financial cost. If you look at down that table, the total cost of the policy is essentially, total cost of the proposals is essentially flat. So to bring in such a large emission savings in the final years, in the final year, 750 is almost as large as the whole emission savings from decarbonising vehicles, electric cars and so forth. So what is it? How will it be funded? I mean, a charitable reading would be that it could be road traffic demand management measures coming in, which could be delivered either as fiscally neutral or potentially raising revenue. But of course, the Scottish Government's current position is quite averse to road traffic demand management. So, pass, we don't know. And it needs to be explained. And why is it put off until the end? Surely we're trying to reduce emissions, get quick reductions in emissions, so surely these savings should be coming in the early part rather than right at the end.
Andrew?
Yes, a few points on the content of RPP2, if I may. The first one is that in moving towards lower emissions, we can also improve air quality. And I don't see a very strong link in RPP2 about how we can get some of the benefits from different technologies with air quality. The second point I'd like to make is RPP2 is a bit light on the topic of road freight, road haulage, and in particular how we might work with that sector in order to decarbonise freight logistics. I think there could be opportunities here, not for total decarbonisation, but partial decarbonisation, for example, using different fuels, such as liquid natural gas, and there is some work starting on that already, but it doesn't seem to be reflected in RPP2. Linked to that, there's a lot of work happening in Europe. There's been recent pronouncements about clean power for transport in Europe, which sets out a whole raft of measures looking at alternative fuels to move transport away from petrol and diesel. And if we do this right, I think we can use this as part of the platform for helping us to move forward in Scotland. And linked to that is some of the opportunities that could come out through the use of liquid natural gas, not just in road transport, but in marine as well. There's opportunities there.
Peter, are you going to want to come in on that point or another one?
I want to just make a point about the RPP2 not having very much about cycling in it, and I think we're missing out on some easy possible wins here. You asked about progress since RPP1, and in fact, in as far as cycling goes, there's been virtually no progress at all. We've had no extra funding, and the funding is still at 1% of the transport budget. So it's not surprising that there hasn't been any progress. And when you look at the RPP2 document, you see that the vast majority of it is about decarbonising of cars. There's almost nothing about alternatives to the car, and yet we know that 40% of car trips are less than 2 miles, and two-thirds of car trips are less than 5 miles. These are distances that could be walked in the case of 2 miles, or cycled in the case of up to 5 miles. So there's a possibility here which is going to require a certain amount of behaviour change on the part of the public, but the government doesn't seem to be taking any effort to encourage this behaviour change. And when you look at RPP2, there's virtually no mention of behaviour change at all. So I think this, and again, you consider other European countries, what they have achieved and what they are achieving in terms of getting people on bikes and leading in this kind of aspect. And of course, they have there's a big knock-on effect in terms of health also, because you notice that the countries which have got high car usage have also got high levels of obesity and all those other diseases which are associated with it. There doesn't seem to be anybody in government who's standing up and saying, look, cycling, or rather transport generally, and health are related, and by making changes in transport we can also get benefits on the health scene. And I think it's time that people in government were standing up and saying that these two are linked, and that we can't have a society where everybody sits around driving around in cars, even if they're electric cars. It's very, very bad for health, and it's got very bad implications in other social ways as well. So I would like to see something like this. If RPP2 is looking forward over this longer period, then these things should be taken into account. And I'm also very unhappy with RPP2, that with that string of zeros for 12 years from transport. I think that the transport emissions should be bringing them down right now, and that we should see some effect within 2 or 3 years, not in 12 or 13 years. And it's just a nonsense to see all these zeros. And I suspect that what it really means, those zeros, is that transport emissions are increasing and are going to continue increasing because of the present policies of building more roads. So, in fact, those zeros should in fact be negative values. They are helping to increase emissions rather than to positively reduce them. See what I mean?
Okay.
Thank you.
Something like a quarter of all emissions from transport, and two-thirds of that's road transport, isn't it? So we should be looking at trying to put downward pressure on that. But firstly, can I bring in our cycling guru on the committee?
But I've never claimed to be the cycling guru, but I'd always defer to those who have got direct expertise in this area. But I think it is, in order to balance the conversation, I think we need to at least recognise that there are a group of MSPs in the Parliament across parties who are working very hard to raise the profile of cycling. And I think we are beginning to see some progress there. So this additional £6 million announced by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance in the budget, I accept that will not go far enough to meet the
the aspirations that have been set in terms of the cycling target. But when the Barnett consequentials were allocated recently for capital investment projects, when £300 million was released to the Scottish Government, all of the capital, the shovel-ready projects that had been identified in cycling to the tune of £3.9 million were given the go-ahead. And that is direct, that is as a result of the pressure that MSPs and cycling organisations have brought to bear on the Government. So I think we perhaps are at the base camp rather than at the mountaintop, but we are, I think, beginning to see a shift in attitudes. I think what would be really helpful is if we could have an exemplar project, perhaps, and that's something that I'm working with colleagues in the cross-party group on cycling to promote, that if you had an award, for example, for a local authority to provide a designated cycle route that actually showed what good practice looks like. Because often, you know, we have a cycle corridor in Edinburgh, which costs £600,000, so it's not insignificant amounts of money, but it's on road. Cyclists are still competing with cars and buses, and it's not the designated cycling routes that we would recognise in Denmark and in Amsterdam, and the kind of cycling infrastructure that you would want to see in Scotland. I think if you have one good project, which wouldn't necessarily cost a lot of money, but would actually act as an example of good practice that other local authorities could follow, I think we could begin to see the shift, the modal shift that people aspire to.
Okay. Keith, you were wanting to come in here?
Thank you, Convener. It was just to make a general point about what the transport section of RPP should be trying to achieve. All the members around the table will know there's a major objection to taking action on climate change from some people, because anything that we can do in Scotland is dwarfed in an instant by what can happen in the rapidly industrialising countries, China and India and so on. Now, I was talking to Malcolm Buchanan, who is a leading transport expert who's been working with the authorities in Shanghai and across China, advising them on what their transport objectives should be. And the officials in China were telling him that they wanted to move away from the stereotypical image of a mass of cyclists, lots of pedestrians, buses moving through their giant mega city, because that was seen as a symptom of China being a backward country. And in order for China to be seen as a modern country, everyone should be in their cars and driving their cars. And that was the lesson they had taken from the development in the Western world. So actually the challenge for RPP and the challenge for Scotland is to demonstrate that a modern country isn't a car-based economy, that we've learned from all the difficulties that creates, and that we are actually trying to turn back the clock, if you like, to a time when walking was the natural choice, when getting on a bike was a natural choice, and using public transport was the natural choice. So I think that's an anecdote to illustrate the ambition that I think RPP could have, that Scotland can lead the way in demonstrating leadership about what a low-carbon economy looks like. Being slightly more specific, what that means for the transport section, I think it's important to highlight a very clear difference within the RPP. If you look at the energy section, there are two fundamental objectives, if you like, decarbonising the energy supply and reducing demand. I think objectives everyone around this table would sign up to. When you look at the transport section, decarbonising transport is an objective, but it says absolutely nothing about reducing demand. And that is a very difficult challenge, everyone would admit. But I think it is a nettle that needs to be grasped, and so certainly we would like to see an acknowledgement within RPP that more transport is not necessarily the objective of government. It's transport as a means rather than an end in itself.
Could I have Elaine first?
Going on from that, are you saying that there's an over-reliance in RPP2 on things like electric cars and hybrid vehicles and so on, and that solution for decarbonisation rather than demand reduction? We see, I mean, the UK government just today, I think, has made announcements about infrastructure for electric cars. Do you think that's all being over-emphasised in our policies at the expense of demand reduction, traffic reduction?
What I would say is decarbonising transport is an essential part, but if you look at the timescales, that's a long timescale involving worldwide action within.
What I'm asking is that doesn't necessarily drive behavioural change. You might think, oh, well, we can have a more efficient car, we can have a less carbon-producing car, but you're actually saying you need to go further than that and actually affect behavioural change.
Behaviour change is a fundamental aspect of cutting climate change emissions, absolutely, and there's action that we can take now and in the medium term to create an environment where you don't need so much transport, if you like, you know, that goods and services are available within shorter distances. So, thank you.
Okay, kind of Tom and then Colin and then Nigel.
Yes, really, it's a reiteration of what's just been said, that effectively there is, I think, it's not a case of either decarbonise transport or deal with demand. It's both. We need both. And I think there is an emphasis in RPP2 on the electric car type approach. And if you look at things like the Climate Change Committee first report in January 2012, they talk about the need to address demand management. It's interesting that at clause 746 in the RPP2, it is stated on the policies and proposals that we have from RPP1, they are not yet being implemented at the intensity required for the abatement figures given in the document. So even within RPP2, there's an acknowledgement that more needs to be done on the measures on demand management that are mentioned, that we're talking about. So I think that one of the obvious ways forward is through measures on demand management, and our position would be that if you're going to do that, you should look at it perhaps in, say, 2016 in four major cities. You might argue that there are going to be workplace levies for parking at workplace positions, and people know what's going to happen. They've got a lead-in, they can prepare, and then they can deal with it. There are a number of demand management measures which may not be easy, but need to be looked at and are not mentioned at all in RPP2.
Nigel, you want to come in on that particular point?
Yes, again, you know, picking up on Lane's question. You know, as the 2020 group, you know, we're looking to take positive actions that will help us to meet some of these targets. And we've just launched the Transport Challenge. And I'd just like to, you know, reiterate the point that we aren't looking at one measure here. What we're offering are four options for organisations to consider, including using electric vehicles, using more public transport, better use of video conferencing in business and organisations, and also fuel-efficient driver training. So a whole raft of measures. And that's because we don't see there's any one measure that is actually going to take us to where we need. We've got to keep all options open, and we've got to push as far and as fast as we can on all of those options.
Colin, were you wanting in?
If I may come back to Jamiri's initial question about you're looking for an exemplar project. I'm sure you're aware of it, but I would direct you to the Smarter Choices, Smarter Places programme, the Sustainable Transport Towns programme that the Scottish Government has been leading over the past few years. It's a shame we don't have Gillian Annable here today, because she, I gather, has been involved in the monitoring and appraisal of that project. But it might be
policy. I think it's recognised that Scotland has some of the best policies and strategies and targets in the world. But actually, when you come to identify designated off-road cycle routes, that is more problematic. And that's where we need to see the improvement. We need to make cycling something that is not seen as being quirky or alternative, but actually a normal mainstream form of transport.
I would certainly agree with all of that, but the Smarter Choices, Smarter Places programme wasn't a policy, it was actually a programme of investment across a number of towns across Scotland. and it followed up a programme, the Sustainable Transport Towns programme in England, which showed very high benefit-cost ratios in terms of delivering emissions reduction, delivering modal shift to cycling. And I would encourage you to pursue that line. I think that really is a good way that we could drive really good examples in cycle use in Scotland. I mean, I would draw you back to the Scottish budget overall, though. I mean, whilst we would welcome the small increases in funding for cycling over the last few years, sustainable transport measures as a part of the whole Scottish government's budget, using their own figures, is 3.6%, 72.9 million out of a total budget of over 2 billion. So really, we need to see that percentage being driven up in order to really see delivery of sustainable transport and much higher cycle rates.
Yes, I think I take up the same point, and it's something that Jim Eady mentioned earlier about the £6 million that's been spent on additionally on cycling measures. The overall transport budget, as you know, is something like £2 billion, and RPP1 called for 5% of that to be devoted to active travel. So 5%, by my calculations, is about £100 million a year. When you try and disaggregate walking from cycling from electric charging points, it's very difficult to work out exactly how much is going to cycling, and that is something that I would like the committee to work on, if possible, so that we can actually see how much money really is going to cycling, rather than from it being in an aggregated mass. And, of course, the RPP1 called for 5%. That was several years ago. Now that we've had no investment in cycling, the figure has to be increased. And a number of organisations have called for 10% of the transport budget to go to active travel. And I think that it's time that this was addressed. In present terms, that would make it between 100 and 200 million being spent on active travel. So Jim Eady's figure of 6 million does look a rather puny amount.
When you can I've been arguing for as much money as possible.
I'm sure you have. Just putting it in context, yeah. Yeah.
Gordon, you're wanting to come in.
Yeah, it was just on the issue of if we're going to try and achieve carbon reduction as quickly as possible, we need some kind of modal shift, as everybody has said. And the easiest and quickest way to do that is in public transport. And Edinburgh is a success story where that's concerned, because over the last 20 years, there has been a substantial movement of people to using public transport. Probably the growth in that period has been roughly 30 to 40 million additional journeys a year. Now, the reason for that, in my view, is that the bus company in Edinburgh is still publicly owned. It's got newer vehicles, cleaner, safer vehicles with CCTV and radio connections for the drivers, and it works on a low-fare, high-volume model. Now, bearing in mind Edinburgh is the exception to the ownership of bus companies in Scotland, I'm interested in anybody's views about how we encourage passenger transport like buses, which serves the vast majority of people, to become more attractive, that people will use it. Because in Edinburgh, it's a whole cross-section of society that uses the buses in Edinburgh, but that is not necessarily the case elsewhere. And is there anything the Scottish Parliament can do to help that modal shift to use public transport?
Colin?
Well, my organisation campaigns for investment in public transport, so we would also want to see greater use of public transport and shift to public transport use. I would, however, slightly contest your initial suggestion that public transport is the best way to reduce emissions. If you look at both the Mitigating Transport's Climate Change Impact Report of 2009 that formed the basis for RPP1, and also RPP1 itself, 2011, the four areas, I make it, that were in both reports as being the most cost-effective in reducing emissions were smarter choices measures, so travel plans, car clubs, lift sharing, that sort of stuff, speed reduction, freight technology, and eco-driving. So these were actually the four areas that the Scottish Government identified as being the most cost-effective at driving emissions reduction in the transport sector. In the initial report, the MTCCI report of 2009, As one of the most cost-effective measures, they did identify bus quality contracts, so heading towards sort of bus regulation type territory, as something that would be very cost-effective in reducing emissions. So there is an evidential base there provided by the government that would support your contention, but it wasn't as... I think the smarter choices measures and the speed reduction generally comes out as the most cost-effective for reducing emissions from transport.
Rachel, you wanted to come in?
Yep. Again, as the 2020 Climate Group, one of the measures we're looking at in the transport challenge is to get greater use of public transport. The route here is actually looking at businesses. Can businesses help their employees to make that choice by taking the bus to work rather than taking a car to work? And also potentially working with the retail sector. So can retail locations start to use more in the way of getting transport routes to get people to shopping centres and the like. So maybe not directly in terms of everybody, but starting to target certain areas where we think, you know, public transport could actually have a part to play. The other one I think is linked to this is coming back to this topic of air quality. The investment by Lothian Buses in not just hybrid buses, but buses that have got emission reduction systems on the exhausts, all contributes to improving the air quality in Edinburgh. And if we can get that transport out of cars, because cars still do actually create quite a lot of pollution, into buses, then there will be a resulting benefit in air quality. And that helps active travel and other things as well.
Okay, Gordon, do you want to come back?
One point on that very issue of Lothian buses getting cleaner engines for, you know, excluding the hybrid buses. The result of that happening is that the miles per gallon figure drops dramatically as each new engine comes on board. And over 15, 20 year figure, I saw in my previous capacity, MPG falling from 6 miles per gallon to 4.8 miles per gallon. So while it was a cleaner engine and there was less emissions, you were actually using more diesel.
Absolutely correct. If you look at the progression from Euro 1 to Euro 6, the air quality gets much better, but the actual miles per gallon gets worse. And that is where hybrid buses come in, as actually clawing back some of those efficiencies. And as well as hybrid buses, what we have as the other option, and this is where Aberdeen is leading, is the potential use of hydrogen buses. So you're actually completely decarbonising the bus fleet. And more importantly, with Aberdeen, they're making the link back into the renewables sector. So the hydrogen for those buses in Aberdeen is coming from a remote wind farm site north of Aberdeen. So it's actually getting the benefits from renewables into transport as well.
In terms of, if you like, the decarbonisation of vehicles, both electric vehicles and the kind of hybrid buses that we're talking about here, is there more that the Scottish Government could be doing in terms of encouraging this switch? And I mean, as you pointed, somebody pointed out earlier, we seem to be depending on EU directives to progress all of this. Is there something that we can do? Can we add value to that particular movement? Nigel?
I'll try to answer this one. If you just looked at cars as an example, the performance of your petrol and new diesel engines getting better all of the time, the efficiencies are getting better all of the time. Then you've got the other technologies coming in, so electric vehicles, plug-in hybrids, fuel cell vehicles, you name it. The general consensus seems to be that looking forward, there will not be any one dominant transport platform type. It's not like it'll be a petrol or a diesel, which is the choice we have at the moment. There'll be a wider range of choices. We think that the type of vehicles may vary according to the type of use you have. So for city centre transport with small cars, for want of a better word, electric vehicles could be very, very well suited, because they've got the right range, the right performance to do that. As you move up to bigger vehicles and longer ranges, then even with the improvements of battery technology, that will be a challenge. And this is where plug-in hybrids and hydrogen fuel cell vehicles could actually start to take a key part of the market. I think the key thing here is that the Scottish Government, I don't think anybody has got all of the answers yet. And I think you need to keep a very close eye on how things are evolving. And I would suggest also take very active participation in UK and EU projects that are helping to demonstrate the technologies as they come out, so that you're ready to take the technology at the point when it actually makes sense. And so you're a very, very close follower. You're taking advantage of the technologies as they become available, not closing out any options. And I think you'll also need to look at no one silver bullet. You won't find that the battery vehicle will do everything, the hydrogen fuel cell won't do everything. It may be then freight, you've got to stick with something like liquid natural gas to actually get the performance on big articulated lorries that the freight companies need. So I don't know if that helps, but there's no simple answer on this one. And the Scottish Government, I think, can facilitate that by keeping an open mind and probably keeping the strategy, an adaptive strategy, so you can actually reflect what's happening at a point in time and take advantage of that, rather than saying, now, this is what we will do. Because 2030 is a long time away. Yeah. A lot will change between now and then. Mm-hmm. And to be very prescriptive about what you do, I think, could be a mistake.
Okay. Thanks for that. Keith and then Colin.
I wanted to come in very briefly to reflect on the difficult balancing act the government would have in terms of supporting more decarbonised vehicles, because there are, of course, subsidy schemes that can be run. It's important to reflect that at a time of austerity, the subsidy schemes quite often subsidise the reasonably well-off people to have a second car, and that unfortunately is proven from south of the border. And in terms of wanting to tackle the inequalities in Scottish society, it's a very difficult issue to balance subsidising additional transport when half of the Scottish population cannot drive a car due to age or income.
Colin?
Just returning to buses. I'm no expert in bus vehicle technology, so I won't be drawn on that topic. But I mean, Convener, in terms of you said, what could the government do? Well, obviously, I would say continue with the Scottish Greener Bus Fund to provide for Lothian buses and others to purchase hybrid buses. Look at opportunities for retrofitting the existing fleet, whether or not that may be more cost effective, perhaps, than the purchase of hybrid buses. I mean, I think generally on buses, Scotland, we do have a real opportunity there. We have one of the world's largest bus manufacturers in Alexander Dennis, and we have two of the Britain's five largest bus operators in First Group and Stagecoach here. So I think we should be making something more of that as a nation. There's a real industrial opportunity there.
Yes, just again on the sort of bigger picture, one aspect of the RPP2 that I think is very good is the way that it lays out principles on behaviour change. And there are 10 insights given, some of which are show leadership, be consistent, and make change as easy as possible. So when you're talking about asking people to get out of their cars and get into buses or to cycle, don't say that sort of thing and then reward people for staying in their cars. You've got to push the rewards towards people who cycle, people who use public transport. When you're looking at measures that can be taken, think about that, and for instance, again, to go back to traffic demand measures and workplace parking levies, you can get money from that from the people who are taking cars into work and use it to fund the people who are wanting to cycle and who are wanting to use public transport. So there are ways in. The government has given us in the RPP2, as I say, very good and sensible principles on what drives behaviour change, but those principles have to inform policy, not just on this, but really across the board.
Elaine.
Just a brief question, something that the Colin referred to a while back, that one of the cost-effective methods of reducing carbon emissions was speed limit reductions. Mm. And I wondered, are you referring in particular to, for example, the reduction of speed limits in towns from 30 to 20 miles an hour, or is it, you know, the faster driving, or, you know, if you were actually going to recommend a policy change, would it be, you know, 20 mile an hour speed limits in urban areas? Or?
Yeah, I mean, we very much are in favour of generally moving towards 20 mile an hour as the limit in urban areas, but not really for climate arguments, more for quality of life issues. Mm-hmm. Keith might have some more comments on this one. I mean, certainly speed reduction was one of the four things.
I've
identified.
What sort of speeds is that getting people, you know, in urban, is that taking the speed limit from 60 down to 50?
In RPP1, the my notes indicate that it was actually more looking at motorway speed limit enforcement, so it was more of the 70 mile an hour speed limit enforcement rather than reducing urban speed limits. I think there is some literature that suggests that reducing speed limits in urban areas has sort of kind of mixed results in terms of emissions reduction impacts. Yeah. Keith, do you have?
I think in terms of RPP, it seems to be focusing on trunk roads. So in terms of your question around 30 to 20 miles an hour, what that solves is the number one barrier to people cycling more, which is fear of traffic and fear of being in a crash. So Colin's absolutely right. It's around the reason for reducing an urban speed limit is to improve quality of life for people. And I think the important point is that as part of modal shift, as Gordon highlighted earlier, if we want to achieve that modal shift, then yes, you cut the speed limit in urban areas and you will have a positive result.
John, you wanted to come in?
Yes, the only point I want to add to this one is the 2020 Climate Group did an event recently on a public debate about the reduction of speed limits. And I think part of the evidence that was presented was that in built-up areas, I think 40 miles an hour was seen to be the optimum in terms of emissions reduction. That's not to say we put 40 miles an hour everywhere. That is just what the academics came back with. If you're minimising your carbon emissions, that was seen as being the sweet spot. But you know, the climate group is trying to get this discussion going, so it's tackling some of the difficult questions as well as some of the very difficult ones.
Yeah, I mean, one element of the sort of four areas that the package that's contained in here in RPP2 and the chapter on transport is seeking road network efficiencies. So the use of average speed cameras and these types of things, or intelligent transport systems, I think they're called. What role do you think they could play in actually reducing emissions? Is this a significant area where we should be investing or not? I mean, if we're talking about reducing speeds and things like that, you have to have the mechanism to do that, and these kind of mechanisms are clearly developing. Colin?
Yes, it's something that we're broadly in favour of. However, if you look at RPP2, page 165, you'll see that the network efficiencies line is very small compared to the other lines in there, the decarbonising vehicles, sustainable communities, etc. So I'm not sure it's got it's the most important thing we need to be looking into. It also didn't come through strongly, as far as my reading of RPP1 and the research that was based upon, as one of the most cost-effective areas. Earlier in the session, I outlined what I indicated were the four consistently most effective measures for reducing emissions, which were speed limit enforcement, smarter choices, freight vehicle technology, and eco-driving.
Keith, and then
Very briefly, there is a focus in RPP on eco-driving, which is good, and ITS is important on trunk roads, very important trunk roads. There's less evidence around its impact within urban areas, but coming back to the previous point, it is about creating an environment conducive to taking the low carbon transport choice, i.e. walking or cycling or potentially on the bus. So, for example, you can try and smooth the traffic flow. You could adjust traffic lights. There are London boroughs that do this, which means that you get a green wave. So if you're driving your car, you drive at 20 miles an hour, you get green light, green light, green light. There's no point accelerating and braking, which we know is an inefficient way of driving, because at the next traffic lights, you'd then be faced with a red light. So that does have a role to play in creating a better environment. But as I say, there's less evidence that I'm aware of around the direct climate change impact.
Nigel, do you want
to? Yes, in our PP1, there was a table which set out some of the costs and the cost per tonne of CO2 reduction for different approaches. And I think ITS, Intelligent Transport Systems, actually came out as being the most expensive measure in terms of CO2 reduction per CO. Now, I find that result quite surprising from a number of angles, and I think that needs to be revisited and the numbers looked at quite carefully. Intelligent transport systems can take all sorts of different shapes and forms, and within the haulage sector, it is now not common practice, but it's pretty standard practice that a lot of the lorries are actually linked by satellite back to a data monitoring station. And the data monitoring station knows exactly where the vehicles are, how fast they're moving, has the driver got his foot to the floor, is he braking roughly? And it all translates back into fuel economy. And the reason the hauliers are doing it is because it saves them money. Now, these are the kind of measures that if you can understand what is starting to work in the commercial sector, how long is it going to be before that can actually go into wider use? And it may not be that long. And the key thing about all of these computerized and communication systems is that the performance and the cost is steadily going down, so that the potential for that to be rolled out on a much wider basis becomes more viable. So all I'm saying here is go back, look at the cost-benefit analysis that was put against ITS in the first RPP. Is that still valid? And also reference it to what's going on in the commercial sector. And does that actually give any pointers in where that might take you?
Another area that maybe Tom can help me with is the SCCS calls on proposals to be upgraded to policies within RPP2, and the point is made that while the government is allocating funds to a number of proposals that will help reduce emissions, that support is not intensive enough, and Peter's already made that point very clear today with regards to cycling. Essentially, I suppose what I'm trying to ask you to address is that the current shape of transport spending, as we've pointed out, is very much focused on roads building and repairs and maintenance, that type of thing. Do we actually need to shift substantially from where we are to where we need to go?
I think the answer to that is yes, we do need to shift. That's shown by the fact that that transport emissions have gone up instead of down. It's shown by what I was saying about behaviour change, where if you want people to change their behaviour, then you effectively have to reward the behaviours you want. What we're doing at the moment is rewarding the behaviours we don't want when it comes to roads and transport. So certainly more of funding needs to go into things like travel planning, into cycling, active travel in general. And if that is done, then I think we have a far better chance of achieving our targets. I think also, as I've said before, when it comes to leadership, the issue of what happens when people take cars into towns needs to be looked at. So demand management, seeing, well, is it appropriate not to have congestion charging, things, workplace parking levies, things that are difficult but nevertheless need to be looked at. They are there too, and it would be useful to know what was to happen on them.
Yeah, it's certainly true that the RPP 2 as currently drafted has no policies, rather, that are led by the Scottish Government. The only policies are EU measures, so European Union car emission standards, essentially. I think it is important that the Scottish Government moves one or more of the proposals in the transport section up into the policies. Now, it's not as if... Now, OK, earlier on I said the Government isn't spending sufficient amount of money on sustainable transport measures, but it is spending some measures, some money on sustainable transport. It's investing in cycling and walking, it's investing in car clubs, in eco-driving, things like this. All of these measures are things that will reduce climate emissions. So the Government not only has policies in favour of these things, it is actually investing in these areas. So I think on those grounds, these items should be moved above the line from proposals up into policies. Specifically, the Government has a target for hitting 10% modal share of cycling by 2020. And I think it's imperative that that specifically be moved into the policy section.
Yes, I'd certainly agree with that. I've always understood that CAPS, that's the Cycling Action Plan for Scotland, was a policy, and it's certainly referred to as such in other documents. So definitely that would be one example that could become one of the policies.
In looking at which proposals might move to policies, I would also consider some of the numbers in terms of what that delivers in terms of overall cost benefit. And a good example would be eco-driving. You know, the numbers suggest that for the investment that you put in to training people, there is a much bigger return in terms of cost saving and consequential benefits. So the ones that give the greatest return, can we bring them forward, do them sooner rather than later? So with eco-driving, they're talking about getting people trained up by 2027, I think, was one of the objectives. Why do we need to wait 13 years before we get people through eco-driver training? If it really is going to deliver good, positive results, we should be doing things sooner rather than later.
Right. Do any of my colleagues want to... Any questions you want to raise? Raise them now, please. Okay. Well, we seem to have exhausted our issues going around the table as far as RPP2. But quite clear, all of you are singing from the same hymn sheet. I can see here. In terms of the current, maybe if we can just conclude with looking at the current transport budget. Essentially, you're suggesting that the likes of road building should be downgraded from obviously there is an economic stimulus that is provided by investing in these kinds of projects, and there is an imperative at the moment to try to boost economic activity. So, I mean, how would you respond to the suggestion that holding back in these kind of projects is not actually going to be very helpful in terms of promoting the economy? Peter?
Yes, we're told that building trunk roads benefits the economy, but I think the evidence is not necessarily all there, and you'll perhaps be aware of that the principles which are used to measure cost-benefit analysis, I think that they're called the STAG principles, which Transport Scotland applies. Now, these principles were devised by Transport Scotland or their predecessors themselves, and they are implemented by Transport Scotland. So you can see that there's no independent assessment of the actual cost-benefit analysis of a trunk road scheme, let's say, for example. And by the same measure, these stag principles don't take into account the benefits from walking and cycling in particular, which can accrue in terms of things like health and reduced congestion preventing urban sprawl and things like that, which are definite benefits to society and which should be taken into account, but are not currently taken into account when these assessments are made. So I would like to see the Transport Committee here taking charge of the principles on which schemes are assessed to see whether the benefits and costs are really being attributed properly and fairly, and to make sure that non-vehicular schemes like active travel get a fair share of the balance.
I would agree with Peter that the economic impact of capital investment in transport is contested. In fact, you had evidence from Professors Tom Rye and Ian Docherty in autumn 2011 on the topic of the Scottish Budget 2012-11, and they led evidence on that very topic contesting the economic impact of investment in capital investment in transport more generally. But to address, and not to go over that ground, to address your question more specifically, if the overall economic imperative is capital investment as an economic stimulus, we would contend, based on evidence prepared by Sustrans Scotland and others, that spending money on smaller scale projects are more likely to see that money retained locally, because the money will be spent by local authorities, by local contractors, rather than going overseas. If we take the example of the Second Forth Road Bridge, the four companies that are building that bridge are, if I remember right, are German, American, and Spanish. So a lot of the money for that project, now we could argue the toss as to whether that's the right project or not, but I think it is incontestable that a lot of those funds are going overseas. If we spend money on local investment, walking, cycling, road maintenance, and so forth, that money will be retained within Scotland.
Thanks. Keith, and then Tom to finish.
Two brief points. As Colin just said at the end, maintenance, you know, maintaining what we've got is very important, and we all know there are huge challenges in maintaining the assets that we already have without necessarily adding to them. Second point is that, you know, we're not just your typical bearded, hairy environmentalist saying no road building ever. We'll sit in the trees to stop it. To take an example from the convener's own constituency, the village of Maybole has been campaigning for a bypass for 40 years. Now, we are working with the community to try and improve the high street now, but also in anticipation that the bypass is built, that you do create an environment conducive to people walking, being physically active, walking to school. It's currently very intimidating for children to walk to school in the community. So it's not a simple case of black and white opposed to all road building. It needs to be the right scheme in the right location. And the bypass of Maybole is a good example. That will retain some benefits. But also, when you invest in the town centre as well, that will also generate an economic stimulus for the local economy, because at the moment, as the convener well knows, it is an extremely unpleasant place to go or to do business in. So I think in terms of looking at the transport budget, we have to look at the fundamental objectives, which is a flourishing economic growth in Scotland to allow all to flourish, and it's that all to flourish that needs to be the key test.
Thanks very much. Tom?
Yes, really, I just wanted to make a comment about sustainability in all this, because of course we're not interested in economic growth on its own, we're interested in sustainable economic growth. And I think on that basis, you should be looking at the issue of roads in the round. And if you look at it in the round, you have to weigh up the benefits of less emissions, less fuel costs, less accidents, less congestion, improved health, improved air quality, more biodiversity. You have to weigh all those things in the balance and consider whether by using less roads, by putting more into active travel and the like, we aren't actually contributing greatly to that sustainable economy. And some of the kind of bigger values that we are looking at when it comes to measuring what is, I suppose, happiness and prosperity in a bigger sense.
Okay, thanks for that, Tom. Peter and then Nigel, you'll be the last contributor.
Just a brief comment about this business of road maintenance. It's been established for cyclists that rough roads take a lot more energy to ride over than a smooth road, and I'm suspecting that the same would be true for vehicles as well. So therefore, if you improve the maintenance of the existing roads that we have, and of course these are mainly local roads, then you will actually get fuel savings from the vehicles that actually use them. So this may have an impact on climate change as well. And certainly it's employing local people to maintain the roads. It's a very good thing.
Thanks, Peter. Nigel, can you finish off our session today?
Question about infrastructure. You can look at it in different ways. So, Aberdeen bypass, that should bring air quality benefits, emissions reduction, et cetera, et cetera. I think the key point I'd like to make is that in looking at the infrastructure investment of the future, you need to link it into some of the other changes that are happening. Look at the national planning frameworks, how they're developing, and how modal shift, so this is moving freight from roads onto potentially sea transport, water transport, could happen. And one example I would give here is that looking in the wider context, climate change is happening. We've got the melting ice in the Arctic, but that's opening up the transport from the northeast and the northwest passage, which could then become a freight route from Europe to the Far East. That actually puts Orkney in potentially a very good position. And Orkney is already in MPF1 and MPF2 as a strategic port. Can these ideas be developed further? Can you actually make something out of this, which is improved infrastructure, but infrastructure that is actually consistent with doing things in a better way and a low emissions transport option?
I think thank you very much, all of you who have contributed to today's roundtable session. I'm sure we'll digest your evidence and put together our report on the basis of what we've heard today. So could I close this particular agenda item and thank all witnesses for attending, and we'll suspend briefly to allow people to move out. Thank you very much. The fifth item on our agenda is on an item of subordinate legislation, consideration of a negative instrument in the Housing Act 2001 Amendment Regulations 2013. This instrument amends the Housing Scotland Act 2001, assistance to registered social landlords and other persons, Grants Regulations 2004, otherwise known as the 2004 Regulations, which provide the mechanics for several grant schemes that are operated by local authorities. The committee is invited to consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on the instrument. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. And can I invite members to comment on this particular instrument? Elaine?
Just with the issue that we'd discussed before the meeting started, I wondered whether it is possible to find out from COSLA. I know that, I mean, technically there's a problem because they haven't consulted COSLA, but would it be possible for us to find out from COSLA whether they actually feel that the two local authorities who were consulted represented their views, in which case, although you might want to draw that to Parliament's attention, that it hadn't been proceeded with in the correct way, there's not that much point in delaying anything if everybody's happy.
Gordon, you want to agree with that?
Just basically agree with it. It makes common sense. You know, that's enough. We've got an issue before making an issue of it.
Down that road. I have no desire to deny the government their policy intent with this. I'm just concerned to ensure that we do this correctly. And I understand what the government's position is in that they consulted on the previous instrument and consequently believe they've effectively consulted on this one too. But if there is a loophole there, I think we need to be cautious and just ensure that everybody is going forward on the same basis.
Okay, well, what the suggestion is to get some written submission from COSLA and from the Scottish Government. Hopefully we could review that at our meeting next week and make a determination on what we wish to do. That's it. Okay. Thanks very much. Move on into private session now.